Hello, everyone, and welcome to the I can't remember now, Victoria. What is it? The third?
The third, I think.
Our third webinar in a series of nine, which we have scheduled for this week, next week. We've got a couple next week, and we'll talk more about that later, and a few the following week. There is more stuff in the pipeline, so keep your eyes out for the stuff which will be going up on social media and on our website. My name is George Heritage. I work in the Assessment Services Department in the Madrid office for Cambridge Assessment English. And this...
My name is Victoria, and I work with George in the Assessment Services Department in the Madrid office.
Right, so A2 Key and A2 Key for Schools, 2020 Revision and Teaching Ideas. What are we going to be looking at today, Victoria?
We are going to be looking at new tasks for A2 Key and Key for Schools. Also, yep. We hope to give you some ideas to develop your students' skills. And finally, we will have a look at some tips and ideas, hopefully practical, to use when teaching.
Yes, and by new tasks, we mean these are new post-revision. So hopefully you all know by now that since January, we've been, candidates have been taking the revised A2 Key, A2 Key for Schools, and B1 Preliminary and B1 Preliminary for Schools. We're happy with the changes. I think people are getting used to them now. So we'll be looking at all four, well, three, well, we're looking at three skills today. We'll be looking at all four skills today. Have a look in a bit more detail at some of the tasks that have changed. And try to give you some practical ideas. Okay. Any questions as we go along in the chat box, please, on the right-hand side. Our colleague David Bradshaw is in there. Between the three of us, we'll do our best to keep on top of your questions and queries. So let's go, Victoria. What are we going to start with?
We are going to start with writing and ways to improve our students' writing.
Lovely. So, in the chat box, what do you think? What helps students improve their writing? No, Anna, she normally sounds like that. Don't worry. And everyone else?
Ooh. Maybe better now?
Yeah, that's much better, Victoria.
Okay, sorry about that. Yeah.
Yes, reading, writing, practice. Practice makes perfect. I think error analysis, very nice vocabulary. Thinking about the topic. Yes, Antonio, using examples, I think, is very important. Vocabulary. Yes, Carla, giving them specific guidelines. If you were in our session yesterday, I think making sure that they're aware of the guidelines and of the criteria can help a lot.
Motivating feedback as well.
Meaningful feedback for a nice brainstorming. Yeah, we'll be looking at some ways to lead up to writing. And we'll be looking at how to scaffold writing for our students. So how to support them, break everything down into stages and support them to help them with their improvement. Process writing, very nice. Mm. Mind mapping, loads of ideas. What did we come up with, Victoria?
Well, we came up with three main categories. So the first one is preparation.
Yep, I think a lot of people have spoken about this here. Brainstorming, linkers, pictures, guidelines, etc. So making sure that they have all of the information that they need and the vocab and the language that they need before they start the writing task. Mm-hmm. The next one, my favorite.
Planning.
Yeah. Planning, I think, is essential, really. I know it's very difficult to get some of our students to really plan properly. But definitely in an exam situation, I think planning is very useful. Mm-hmm. I used to tell my students use between 5% and 10% of the entire time in the exam planning before you start writing. And Victoria?
Reviewing.
Reviewing, I think almost as important as planning. Obviously going back, looking out for any errors, any slips, making sure that, you know, you've used a nice range of language, etc. So in a little bit more detail, preparation, Victoria?
Yeah, preparation includes, of course, motivation. For example, using videos to get our students interested in the topic, help them visualize the situation, think about the details of the situation, ask them how they could react or feel if something like this happened, have a little discussion.
Yeah.
Also,
activate their schemata.
Exactly.
I think a lot of people were talking about guidelines and clear guidelines, etc. Conventions, being aware of the conventions of writing, what is expected of them in an email, in a letter, in a review. We're focusing on A2 today. So what kind of task types will they be asked to write, Victoria?
What tasks? At A2, they will need to write a story.
Yep, a story and a short note or a paragraph. That part hasn't changed. The old part 9, I think, remains in key, but it's moved down to part 6 now, I think. And the new part 7 is the 3-picture story task.
Yeah.
Okay. I think obviously writing examples, giving examples of what is expected of them. You can find good writing examples, well, a variety of writing examples in the teacher's handbook to help you with assessing your writing, your students' writing, and giving them examples of, you know, what they need to do to get the marks. And I mentioned before, Victoria?
Scaffolding. This is taking a step-by-step approach, helping our students to build on their abilities and increase them and feel more confident when writing.
Yeah. So moving on to planning, we spoke about some aspects of this yesterday. I think, again, like earlier we were talking about conventions, I think planning, they've got to bear the task requirements in mind. So again, a lot of you said giving them clear guidelines, etc. But I think what is being asked of them? What information do they need to include? How do they need to present it? Obviously feeds into planning. Somebody mentioned earlier organizing ideas. How do you organize your ideas, Victoria?
I find it difficult, George.
you never seem like you find it difficult. yeah, but this will feed into the general organization of the writing afterwards, making sure that there's a clear progression in the ideas, depending on the task type, of course. The purpose will always influence everything. So interlinked again with the task requirements, what is the purpose of what they're doing? Is it writing a story to entertain? Is it a small paragraph to inform? And always bear the target reader in mind. We're talking about this yesterday, the sociolinguistic aspect. So being aware of who you're writing to, who your audience is, will obviously affect the language that you use, the vocabulary that you use, perhaps. All of these feed into planning, I think. And once the writing has been done?
Reviewing. And this includes making sure that we try and use synonyms, also that there is a variety of grammar. And this also, we need to take into account the level. Of course, the range is going to be assessed in terms of the level, the student's level. Also checking that there is not too much repetition, although repetition is not always negative.
Especially down at this level, I think, and in stories especially, repetition can work as a sort of cohesive device. So don't tell all of the students, don't repeat any words, because in some cases it is necessary.
Yeah. Definitely.
Again, the task requirements, we think about it at the planning stage, and then when we review, have I done this, this, and this? Will I get the marks for content, etc.? And, or have you already mentioned it, Victoria?
No, I haven't. No. I'm just making sure that there are not too many mistakes.
Exactly. Any errors or slips that they've made whilst they're writing. A few other things we came up with.
Teacher feedback obviously is very valuable and always necessary, but also peer assessment, self-assessment, they are really useful to make our students aware of assessment and how they can improve, but also what they are doing well.
Yeah.
It is true that students don't have the same abilities, so they can help each other and try to collaborate to improve in general.
Mm-hmm. I think peer assessment, it takes a while to set up, but I think if it's set up properly and it becomes something routine, it can be very, very useful. And actually, thinking about the current situation, I know sometimes teachers steer away from peer assessment because they're perhaps concerned about, you know, how weaker students might feel in a class situation. But if everybody's working online, I think it gives us much more, many more opportunities for successful peer assessment and maybe some collaborative work. We'll look at that a bit later.
Mm-hmm.
Your feedback, obviously, which lots and lots of different ways to give feedback on writing. We're doing a session specifically on giving feedback on writing on the 6th of April, I think, week Monday. So if you're interested in that, come along, please. Our learning diary. What do we mean by learning diary, Victoria?
Well, keeping the different writing tasks that our students have done well. They should do it. They should keep all their writing tasks so that they can see their progress. Also keeping a record of the mistakes they have been making.
Yeah, and so they can see how they have improved over time.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
I think there are various approaches. Like Victoria was saying, keeping a portfolio, let's say, a portfolio of their writing. But a little learning diary, maybe, I think keeping vocab books and things. I don't know how many students do that now. I always used to. I'm sure you had hundreds of vocab books, Victoria. That is, in a sense, a form of learning diary, I think.
Yeah.
And we'll look briefly today at write and improve. We looked at it in a lot of detail yesterday. And that, I think, provides a wonderful opportunity for a sort of online digital learning diary.
Definitely.
Which can help them keep track and keep a record of how their work has been progressing, hopefully for the better. Right, so
moving on to
maybe one of the hardest areas sometimes with writing.
I think digital resources are very motivating for the students because they like it, they like them, and I think they find it very easy to use, so we have a resource there.
Yeah, and I mean, with all of the resources available now, you can use images, you can use videos, you can use recordings to sort of spark interest, get students motivated. I think it's, depending on the size of your class, obviously, but I think it's important to try and provide input in as many different media as possible, because as we know, some people work much better visually, orally, kinesthetically even. So I think always bearing that in mind with larger groups of students is also important. Moving on, Victoria. Exciting.
We're going to have a look at Padlet.
Right, so how many of you use Padlet already? And more interestingly, how do you use Padlet? We've heard from lots of different teachers about different ways of learning Padlet. So do any of you use this? And if so, how? Everybody's typing at once. Never used it. Denise for resources. Okay. Well, Padlet, it's not our resource or our product. It's free. It's online. You go to the homepage, you sign up. It's very easy to use, and you can use it in lots and lots of different ways. You can look at lots of different students' work all together. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Students can share and discuss each other's work, their writing, for example. Mm-hmm. We gave a presentation at a school a month or so ago, and they use Padlet for everything, for communicating with parents, students, etc. And yeah, it's free, it's online. I know they was having a couple of problems last week or 2 weeks ago, I think, when there was a massive increase in people working from home, but check it out. It has a lot of possibilities. We're going to have a quick look at this. Is the new writing task, Key and Key for Schools part 7. So three pictures, and the candidates are asked to look at the pictures, write the story shown in the pictures in 35 words or more. So how might we use Padlet to lead in or set up a writing task like this, Victoria?
Well, we can get them to practice vocab and come up with examples of how to use this vocabulary in context. So, for example, for this task that we have here, what is the topic you think of the story, George?
The main focus of the story seems to be the picnic.
Yeah.
Do you enjoy picnics, Victoria? When did you last go for a picnic?
I think last year, last May.
Really?
Crikey. Yeah.
Just quickly, Elaine, no, they are not required to use the past tense. Probably better if they stick to either present or past, but they're not required to use the past tense in a story. We could have some budding young Virginia Woolfs in the exam, and we wouldn't want to put them off at all. Okay. So picnics, how could we use this, Victoria? Padlet?
Well, we can set up different columns for expressions with the word picnic or just the word itself, and get our students to write sentences using these expressions or phrases.
Exactly. So you can give them a bit of support, have a picnic, go for a picnic, picnics. Mm-hmm. And then, as you can see, you send the link out to your students and they can come in and write sentences or little chunks of language using the prompts that you have given them. Mm-hmm. So you could give them that for homework, and then you can look at everybody's language together and ask them to now write the story using the language that is there. So it's a really nice opportunity for much more collaborative learning. Yes, Christina. I mean, they can use any tense they want, really. Past simple is sort of, you know, past simple, past continuous is quite a natural tense for stories, but there are no rules about what tense they have to use. Okay. Have a play with this. If you're teaching online now or teaching from home, have a go with Padlet. Send it to your students, see how it works. We had some very good ideas this morning from teachers using this. Do you remember the details, Victoria, using this for collaborative writing?
Oh, I didn't remember really, but no, sorry.
There was a lot going on in the chat box.
Yeah.
Maybe David remembers. But yeah, it was essentially that. Giving them prompts, using it for the input, letting them in a structured and quite a free way add what they want. And then you can gather together everybody's work, everybody's knowledge, and they can learn from each other. Mm-hmm. Thank you, David. Exactly. I think being consistent in the story is more important than which tense you actually use. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, I hope, you can use it during class. I mean, if you're teaching online, definitely put it up on the screen and use that. If you're in the classrooms at the moment, or when you are back in classrooms, you can use it on digital whiteboards. Your candidates could use their phones, depending on what your views are on telephones in the classroom. There's quite a variety of views on that around the world. So please use it. We've had great feedback, great ideas. I think it's a really good resource for all of you to use. Right. So this is an example of how we could scaffold, how we can scaffold the writing process.
We are going to look at two ideas mainly. Okay, this one was also a nice way to take a step-by-step approach. But the one we're going to look at now is one using story titles. So you give your students these story titles, or others, of course, and you can get them to brainstorm. Okay, brainstorm what they think the stories will be about.
On Padlet, for example, or you could set up a different board, five different boards on Padlet with those titles, for example. Get them just to brainstorm vocab. Carry on, Victoria, sorry.
No, thank you. And then you can get your students to choose one title and then draw three pictures based on their story. And then they can take a picture of their drawings and then send it to one of their classmates. And this classmate will have to write a story based on his or her friend's pictures. And then if you want to, they can even read it aloud and record themselves telling the story.
This is where everyone got excited this morning. Sorry, I forgot. Yeah, just using a simple structure like this and using Padlet to brainstorm, to put ideas together. You can get artwork up there, get videos even up there, depending on the legal situation with that, but recordings of themselves, you can get them reading each other's stories. I don't know, I remember trying this a few times in class. It didn't work very well, but you can pass stories round. Did you ever do that, Victoria? So you write a sentence, and then the next student writes a sentence.
It got
some classes crazy. It worked very well, some classes it was a complete disaster, but you know, we can try. Okay, another option, slightly more exam task focused, Victoria, to try and help students with this.
Maybe you have to write sentences based on the story, then divide them and get students to match the two halves of the sentences.
Exactly. So you as teachers, you could write four or five versions of this story, for example, and then separate all the sentences out, split them into two. This is more higher order thinking skills, matching and then also reordering. So you could jumble all the order up. Firstly, get them to match the two halves of all the sentences together, and then make sure that they put them in the correct order, so it follows the pictures and it progresses logically.
Definitely. And using their handouts, George, you may want to share them.
Give you the access to this now. Are there any other activities on there, Victoria? I think there are a couple of
there are.
You should be able to download that now from the right-hand side. Okay. For those of you who have been with us previously, we've looked at Write and Improve in a lot of detail. But for those of you who aren't aware of it, we'll look over it quickly. So Write and Improve is a great tool. It's online. You go to writeandimprove.com. You get to this landing page, sign in, create an account. You don't have to create an account, but it's better if you do, because then you get every iteration of what you've done and a view of the progress. You enter, and then you have access to beginner, intermediate, and advanced workbooks. So A1, A2 for beginner, B1, B2 for intermediate, C levels for advanced. Various fairly familiar question types. They're all based very much on the writing questions that students will encounter in the exam. Choose the one that they want to answer. And then they type their answer into the box. They can also copy and paste it from a Word document. You don't have to do it you don't have to type within the platform, but you do have that option. It also works on mobiles, tablets, and the computer, so they can do this wherever they want. Enter their text and then click the check button at the bottom. And what happens, Victoria?
Then they will get instant feedback. The feedback that they will get is information about the content, how well they did in terms of content.
You can see that at the bottom. Did you write about the question?
Yeah. And then also feedback at word and sentence level. So spelling, grammar.
The turquoise exclamation marks are word level feedback. So here, is the spelling correct? Did you mean to write this? But this is not, I'm sorry if you've heard me say this before, it's not just the spell checker. Okay, at the phrase and sentence level, you can see the areas that are highlighted or highlit. What do you think, Victoria? Highlighted, probably.
Yeah.
And it directs the students towards where it thinks the problems are, but doesn't give them the answer. So, suspicious. Is this a correct word? This doesn't look right to us. So again, it directs them towards where the problems are. So they can then make the changes that they need to. Click on check once again, and they get the same feedback, but with the changes taken into account. So they get a visual record of all of the versions of the writing that they've done. Mm-hmm. This is the feedback screen we're looking at now. There's also a changes screen, which highlights in red and crosses out and highlights in red the things that have changed from one version to the next, and highlights in green the new stuff, so that they can see where they've changed, see if it's improved, see if it's got better.
Mm-hmm.
The link is just write and improve, write and improve.com, and we will be giving you a handout later on with useful links to all of these. Okay, so if you haven't used it before, please use it, and especially at the moment with everybody at home, it's a wonderful resource for writing.
It really is.
And it works from A1 all the way up to C2+. If you're more interested in writing, you can look on YouTube for the webinar we did yesterday, which was called The Write Criteria. The mistake was intentional. It's a bad joke. The right criteria, if you Google this, and we look at write and improve in a lot more detail than we have time for now. I'm not sure about that, Christina. I know 3 or 4 years ago, it still needed some practice, but now it's pretty reliable.
Mm-hmm.
So we've had a look at writing. Sorry, we've had a look at writing. Mm-hmm. On to Victoria.
Reading.
Well done. Yes, Victoria, go on.
Yes, so we're going to look at ways to help your students develop their reading skills. And here we're going to look at first prediction. Okay, so looking at headings, pictures, and also their ideas, their own previous knowledge about the topic. And obviously they will also need to take into account different text types. They will need to get familiar with these text types and also have a better understanding of text structure. Also, George, develop different sub skills.
Yeah, I mean, at A2 and Key, they're not really practicing a huge variety of different types of reading because the texts are very small. We'll talk more in more detail about that tomorrow in the B1 presentation. But yeah, locating information, coming up with strategies to deal with unknown vocabulary, very important at this level, I think, feeds in again to the next stage, which is vocabulary. So let's move on and have a look at a few more. These should look familiar. It's time for a quiz, everyone. I know you love quizzes. What do we have here, Victoria?
We have different examples of the A2 Key and B1 Preliminary Reading Part 1.
So we have 6 examples here. Mm-hmm. 3 of them are A2 and 3 of them are B1. So we would like you in the chat box to write which ones you think are A2, which 3 of these are A2, and think about it, concentrate. It'll be interesting to see how many people fall into the trap, Victoria. Quite a few fell into the trap this morning. Which of these, A, B, C, D, E, F? Yeah, A, B, C, D, E, F.
Yeah.
which of these are taken from A2 Key?
Hmm.
Oh, Agustina, she's fallen into the trap. Says Monica. I think most people have. CD, CFD, CDF, CDF. Got quite a mixture going on here.
Yeah.
Okay, the majority of you got at least 2 out of 3. The answer is, in fact, A.
D.
F. Oh, okay, A, D, and F.
Yeah.
Yep, a lot of you went for C, I think, because why, Victoria? Why were people tempted to go for C?
Yeah, because the text is shorter.
Yeah.
However, it is more complex.
I think
the structure is more complex.
Yeah, I think this is one of the most complex ones, to be honest. Is B. Yeah, B's not too complex. E is fairly complex, but C, no groups of 4 or more unless by previous arrangement. There's quite a lot going on in there. I think by previous arrangement, it's probably above level, definitely. Mm. But also just the semantic aspect of that notice is above level, we would say. So yeah, everyone went for C because it was shorter, but no. sorry. And D is from Kiefer Schools. F could easily be from Kiefer Schools as well, but it isn't. A, probably not. As you know, there's no difference in level between Key and Kiefer Schools. The linguistic requirements and the language level that they're tested on is exactly the same. And the certificate that they receive afterwards is an A2 certificate. It's not for schools or a not for schools certificate. Mm-hmm. The only difference is we try to make the for schools versions of the exams more accessible and more sort of relevant to school aged candidates. Okay. So yeah, this is the part one, which looks very similar in key and preliminary. It's a nice starting place to practice our reading and our writing. What kind of material should students be familiar with for this, Victoria?
Well, they will find notices, signs, instructions, emails, messages, notes, postcards. So it is great if you can give them as much practice as possible with these, not only reading, but also maybe producing their own texts, their own emails, messages. Now, even more than if you are teaching online, they won't see each other.
Yeah. And I imagine most of our students are much more competent with computers than we are. So, you know, set them free.
Yeah.
Just make some interesting notices, warnings, signs, etc. When we are back in the classroom, it's really nice for group work, etc. And you can, you know, get them to create these and stick them up around the classroom.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Right, prediction. We're going to look at it in terms of reading now, but predicting and training our students to predict is important, for all skills, I think. Listening in particular. We'll look in a bit more detail later for listening. But how can we go about setting up reading tasks and encouraging our students to predict before they start the reading, Victoria?
Well, they should... we are going to look at a very specific example here for A2 Key for Schools Reading Part 3. In this case, we are asking our students to look at the title and the story and then get them to predict the type of information that they are going to find. What we have done is remove chunks of this text and we have presented them to our students and also chunks from other different texts on a similar topic.
Exactly. So if you know that you're going to be looking at 4 or 5 different texts over 2 weeks, take little bits out of all of them and just give them this as which of these would we find in this text? No one's answering at the moment. It's interesting. This morning, well done. This morning, the teachers were just doing all the exercises, not really listening to us at all, I don't think. So yeah, have a quick go in the chat box now. Well, God, Natalie's on fire.
Mm-hmm.
Which of these would you expect to find in starting at a new school? Everyone's just copying each other. No, I'm joking, I'm joking. You're all typing at the same time, I know.
Yeah, but my first week proved quite popular today, this morning as well.
Well, I wonder why, Victoria, I wonder why. There's some good distractors in here as well, because some of them, I mean, well, I'll tell you once we say, oh, Gisella, exactly. That's what I thought when I first saw this. I remember when I was definitely at primary school, the school secretary was the most important and powerful person in the entire school. She was one of those teachers that, yeah, you definitely respected and you would definitely not see how scary she should be. You know what I mean? You know, there were those teachers which were just scary, but then there are those ones that you didn't even want to find out. So here are the answers. Unfortunately, secretary wasn't taken from that text, but it doesn't matter. We've all been looking at the vocab and thinking about the vocab. It's a nice way to pull maybe some slightly trickier vocab out of a reading text beforehand, so you can get over any problems the students might encounter there before we go into the exercise. Okay, this doesn't take very much prep for you as teachers at all. Okay, what's next, Victoria?
We're going to continue giving ideas for content prediction.
Oh yeah, but nice.
In this case, we are going to focus on reading part three. So in this case, our students will have to fill in a gap with one word, and it is important that we ask them to look at what comes before and after the gap so that they can predict the type of word.
I mean, you know that we get more and more gap fill exercises that become more difficult as we go up the levels. But again, just taking a few sentences out of the reading beforehand, turning it into a gap fill, good for their vocab, good for their use of English. Everybody's answering now. Excellent. Excited.
Worried.
Worried. I'm so glad about the change. Very nice, Pulad. Excited, glad, happy, excited. Stressed, could be stressed. She doesn't look very stressed there. Again, here we're using visual support as well. We did in the previous
activity.
I think being aware, and if you are doing a lot of work online, it's very easy to provide visual support at the same time. So we're at least doing our best to present the information in as many different ways as possible for our different students. Okay. So moving on from predicting content, we all mentioned this earlier. Vocabulary is essential. I think vocabulary is, well, it's always very useful, but at low levels, it's a much bigger focus on vocabulary than on other areas. Some ideas for developing vocabulary, Victoria?
Yeah, to prepare our students for reading, we can get them to match these words with the similar words that are highlighted or underlined in the sentences. So in this way, they will be becoming familiar with synonyms or words that have a similar meaning in this context.
Yeah, these are above A2. It's a bit of these are more sort of B1, B2, I should think. But exactly, synonyms, Carla. It's easy for you to do. It's a very nice way to get them practicing. Try and keep building their vocabulary. Is everybody answering this now? There's a delay in the chat box. This morning, everybody had stopped listening to us by this point. There you go, Michelin. The eagle-eyed amongst you will notice that some of them are actually double keys. So I'd say we booked to go out for dinner. We arranged to go out for dinner. He arranged a room at the hotel in advance. He booked a room at the hotel in advance. Yeah, I mean, this is a general approach that we're looking at. It's not all at level. Maybe a little bit of the top end of A2, but this is more B, I would say. It's easy. J- just a little bit of prep before approaching texts can make everything easier for the candidates and help them with other skills and especially vocab development as well. Right. What are we looking at now, Victoria? Oh, no, we got one more.
Are going to continue with vocab, but in this case, to prepare for writing and using our word lists.
Yep.
Okay, that are available for each level.
Yep. Word lists. We publish word lists for pre-A1 starters, A1 movers, A2 flyers, A2 key, and B1 preliminary.
Mm-hmm.
You can find these online. They're a really useful resource. And no word would ever appear in the exam that does not feature on the word list. Yes, got it right that time. We got it right. That's definitely above A2. So they're a really nice resource for you to use. And I think you can reorder them by topic. So it's a nice way to sort of break vocab learning up into chunks. This idea, you can ask a different student every week, give them the choice, or you could give one student a noun, one a verb, one an adverb, one an adjective a week. Get these four words up on your Padlet, perhaps, or on the walls of the classroom, and say that every piece of writing we need to do this week, or just one story that we need to do this week, has to include these words. It's a nice way of focusing on selected vocabulary for a week and then change next week. And if they're up on the wall or if they're up on Padlet for a week, then you've got four words a week. And let's say you teach for 30, 35 weeks a year, at least they will have learned 120 words by the end of the year.
Hopefully some more, George.
Exactly. And I think this is great at all levels. It can make things much more exciting. I've done this before. I used to have little challenges with people at university. Can you get this word into your essay? Whoever got it into their essay in the most imaginative way won a prize or was bought a beer. So it's easy and it's fun. Right, we've done writing, we've done reading. What next, Victoria?
We are going to look at listening now.
Pardon?
Listening, George.
What?
Again?
I did that this morning. I fell for it. So there are lots of different factors, as we all know, that makes listening difficult in another language. What are your ideas in the chat box, please? What makes listening in another language difficult? Thank you, David. David's posted the link to the A2 vocab list.
Yeah, and also the young learners, I think so.
And young learners below.
Before.
What makes listening in another language difficult? Accent, speed, accent pronunciation.
Unfamiliar vocab,
yeah. Very nice, Therese, because we speak like this. Yep, connected speech. stress, accent. Speed, dialect, accent, stress, the chain of sounds. Yeah, I think connected speech particularly, because, you know, when we're reading, words are separate, but not when we're speaking, always. Cadence, definitely, intonation, unknown vocab. Excellent. Yeah, everybody's correct. what did we come up with, Victoria?
Yeah, we thought that concentration and attention is a challenge, and our students may find this difficult to be paying attention for a long time. Also, keeping up their level of interest.
What did you say, Victoria? Sorry, I was distracted. making sure they're interested enough in what they're listening to, which goes back to the motivation. Carry on, Victoria. Sorry, I couldn't resist.
giving them or having enough processing time to understand like content, and if it's complex as well, this makes things more difficult. Also, background knowledge, although we try not to include these in our exams,
as far as possible to make sure that all of the material in the exams is neutral and that there's no background knowledge is required. I think the understanding of the context, the context can change how easy something is to understand enormously I think. Mm-hmm. So as you know, within the exam at least, there's always an introduction in the rubric, which sort of sets the scene, gives them the context. Visual support. Victoria, I think somebody has asked, what is the name of the animal in that picture? Do you think it might be Victoria? Or no, maybe they meant, what species is it? I think David knows. I think David knows what species this is. It could be George. I think it looks more like a Victoria to me. And identifying the speaker's purpose, which again links into the context. To a degree, I think if we know what the speaker's trying to achieve, it will make things. Oh, thank you, David. A fennec. What is a fennec? One of those, apparently. I've never seen a fox that looks like that, Gisela. Maybe. I said, where are you from, Gisela? European foxes definitely don't look like that. Speed, Virginia. Yeah, that took quite a long time for that to arrive. So maybe there's a delay with your connection. So all of these definitely make, yes. I think it would probably be a dog Yoda. Other areas, everybody mentioned this. Everybody mentioned accent and pronunciation. Mm-hmm. So different features of pronunciation. Thank you, Lydia. Thank you, David. I take my words back, Gisela. I'm sorry, I did clarify that European foxes don't look like that. Pronunciation features. Yeah. It's different from what they're used to or what they're expecting, I think, can be a big problem. The speed, always an issue in another language. The accent. So I think the first one and the third one, we have to make sure that our students are familiar with or have been exposed to a variety of accents. In our exams, we use a variety of native accents. So North American, various areas of the US and Canada, English, Southern English, Northern English, Welsh, Scottish, Irish, Australian, New Zealand, maybe South Africa. At A2, especially, we would never really use examples of very pronounced accents, let's say. I don't think that's the most diplomatic way to say that. But we do try and ensure, even in young learners, that the speech is as natural as possible. Our actors are told, obviously, to speak more clearly and slowly at A2, but we always try and ensure that our recordings are natural. They won't be talking like this. So exposing, it's getting your students used to the material, the kind of material that we use using the tests, I think, is paramount. Intonation, somebody mentioned earlier, cadence, to similar, I suppose. Intonation, I know in English, intonation can be very powerful and can change the meaning of things in many other languages as well. But if your native language is syllable timed rather than stress timed, this is quite a big, there's quite a big difference. I mean, I can say, nice dress, Victoria, or nice dress, Victoria, and mean the complete opposite. So obviously at A2, we don't play around with intonation and meaning it hugely, but as we get higher up, definitely. There you go, a use of a filler. self-correction, again, in our A2 listening, you know what those part ones are like. Are we going to the park today? Yes, we are, aren't we? Oh, no, we're not going to the park. We're going to the swimming pool. No, we're going to the supermarket. they have to be aware, have to be listening out for changes in opinion, changes in direction in what is being spoken about, and also repetition. Yes, Elaine, the distractors, the incorrect options, what we call distractors, which become more and more distracting the higher the level. Anything to add there, Victoria? Sorry, I babbled on there, didn't I?
No, we've seen the problems and now we're going to see how we can help our students.
Excellent. So?
We're going to try and give you ideas to help your students before listening, during listening, and just in general.
Exactly. And yes, Lucia, when we're doing a multiple choice, all options will be mentioned, mm-hmm. the correct answer and the distractors. Otherwise, it would be far too easy. So, before listening, during listening, and in general. All yours, Victoria.
Well, for listening part four, you can see that there is an introductory context or scene setting sentence. So make sure that your students read them carefully. Also, look at the different answers and try to predict what the conversation will be about.
And the STEM, especially. Mm-hmm. So we said earlier about how context is important. The context here, you'll hear two friends talking about a book they've read. Mm-hmm. But the most important thing in all of this, really, is they agree that it has. Mm-hmm. Okay, so they've got to listen out for whether the friends agree. Not just listen out for lots of action, realistic characters, and unexpected ending, because they will, as you've said, they will all be mentioned. Mm-hmm. Make sure they read the question, please. Moving on.
Yeah, for listening part one, the great advantage is that they have visual stimuli. They have the different pictures, so they will be able to have this help to predict and anticipate what the content of the recording will be about.
Yes, they've got to predict, be ready for what to listen out for, be aware mm-hmm. of what they're listening out for. The part one is the first part. That wasn't what I was going to say. Part one, in all of our exams, we try as far as possible for the task to get easier as the harder as the exam progresses. Mm-hmm. So part one is statistically the easiest part. It has the most support, etc. We want the students to feel comfortable and sort of warm up. Mm-hmm. So here they do have the most support out of all of the tasks. Mm-hmm. Okay. Get them using the time before the task to sit and think about what they're going to be listening for, so they're not taken by surprise.
Yeah. And just in general, some teaching tips. Encourage your students to first look at the question and pictures. Obviously, say what they see in the pictures and what the people in the recording are likely to be talking about. And if possible, make predictions on which is the correct answer. And these may turn into a more fun activity.
Yeah. I'm just going to answer Alejandro. It's a very interesting question, Alejandro. David may be drafting something for you. I'm not sure. but it's very difficult, I think, to really isolate any skill per se. I mean, in the listening test, yeah, thank you. In the listening test, we're also testing their reading. In the speaking test, obviously, we're testing their listening as well. It's called the listening exam, the speaking exam, but I think assessing things individually is almost impossible. But we have to focus more on one skill than another. And again, as David said, if they have stronger listening, or if their one skill is stronger than the other, we wouldn't want the listening to affect the candidate's performance in the speaking, or vice versa. You see what I mean? So everything is interlinked, and we try to separate them out as far as we can, but we are still testing various skills at the same time. Try reconnecting, Sonia. Try to reconnect at the top. Sorry for that little segue. It was a very interesting point that Alejandro mm-hmm. made. So, Victoria, continue. Sorry.
Also, to help our students while they are doing the listening task, it is always a good idea to use the tape script. There are different approaches of how to do that, maybe before the listening, while listening, but it is always a very useful resource.
Yeah, I think it's a great resource. I think this plays into exactly what Alejandro was just saying. It's very difficult to teach or to test just one skill at once. And using tape scripts, you're going to be using reading, listening, you can use them for discussion thereafter, you can use them for writing. David has a very nice exercise on the part one, the one that we looked at with the three options, and what people were saying about distractors. Use the tape script afterwards, give it to the students, and get them to edit or to rewrite the tape script to change the answer. So if it's answer B originally, rewrite it so that answer C is correct and B is incorrect. It's a really nice way to take advantage of the resources available to you. Listening again, repeating it more than twice, only twice in our exams, but obviously you can repeat it as many times as you want. Maybe not too many times if it's just a key part one. and helping them build their confidence, getting used to listening, and getting them used to picking out key information. I think using the tape script, etc., is a really nice way to help them practice that. Listening skills, and generally, we've mentioned these teaching pronunciation features. Victoria, what else?
Yeah, exposing our students to a variety of texts and accents, as many as possible, and then also teach inference skills.
Yeah. Teaching inference, I think at this level, it's a bit tricky. Reading between the lines, or listening between the lines, or trying to decide what somebody means from what they say, or in some cases, like we were talking about earlier, how they are saying it. I don't think this is that relevant really at A2.
Yeah, it becomes more important
more at the
high levels.
Okay. Right.
Yeah. Now, some information about where to practice listening or any other skill online on our website. There is a section, Learning English, and students will be able to filter by skill, level, and also time, and we will suggest a number of activities for them. I think this is a great resource also for like teaching online situation.
Yeah, I think there are between 80 and 90 activities in total across all the levels, but if you see here, we clicked on listening, pronunciation, basic, independent. You've got 24 activities ready to go. And yeah, as Victoria said, it is, especially at lower levels, we recognize that it's difficult. We try to produce as much material as possible. And our colleagues at Cambridge University Press, but it is difficult. It is difficult sometimes to find a lot of good listening material at these lower levels. Pilar, I will let you all have it now, okay? In a second, I'll give you a link to a document with all of the useful links, okay? But again, all of these links can be found via our main website that will channel you to anything you need, really. Pilar, if you're from a Spanish-speaking background, which I imagine you probably are, Cambridge Para Ti is the Spanish landing page, and you can find everything via that, really. Okay. Right, so Victoria, moving on.
Yeah.
You click the next slide. I'm finding the file.
Okay.
For our attendees.
So we are going to look in a bit more detail for the revised exam, the A2 Key and Key for Schools, the 2020 version. And you can see that there is not too much change, but what it has been revised is that part two and part five have changed places.
Yep.
As George said, we try to make tasks more increase the difficulty or the complexity of the tasks as the exam progresses. So we saw that
since the last revision, it has become clear that the old part two was a little bit trickier. So they've swapped places so that we have that progression as the students go through. And Victoria, there's a new part four.
Yeah, there is a new part four with five short monologues or dialogues with multiple choice questions.
Okay. Yep. On the right hand side, the files on the right hand side, you can download that that document on the right hand side, which is full of useful links to all of our resources and more. So another time for a quiz. Which of these, we have four can-do statements here. Two are from A2 and two are from B1. So in the chat box on the right-hand side, which two of these are A2? Goodbye if you have to leave. Thank you for coming. We're going to probably be another sort of 15, 20 minutes. So if you can stay, do, and we'll finish off looking at speaking. But if not, thank you for coming and goodbye. For people who are staying, which two of these are A2? One, two, three, or four? Go. Quite a mixture of answers going on. Candelaria, bit of self-correction by the speaker there. Thank you very much. Yes, two and three are A2. I think the main difference is here, meet needs of a concrete type, provided speech is clearly and slowly articulated. And again, related to areas of most immediate priority. Again, provided speech is clearly and slowly articulated. The main difference, B1, as I think we were talking about this yesterday or the day before, B1 is the beginning of more genuine language that people are bringing it a bit more into the real world, I think. So straightforward factual information about common everyday jobs related, common everyday or job related topics, general messages, some specific details. Again, the main points of clear standard speech on familiar matters regularly encountered in slightly more genuine circumstances. Okay. Our colleagues at Cambridge University Press have published, they've got a lot of material on the revision, as have we if you go to our website. But if you Google with Cambridge University Press, they published a series of these useful exam tips. There's an example of one for new listening part four, and these are useful for you as teachers and to share with your students. And that is it for listening. What are we going to finish with, Victoria?
We're going to finish with speaking.
Well done. So can anybody let us know in the chat box, what is the big change to the A2 key in Key for School? What's the big difference, the big change that has come in with the revision? See you tomorrow, Pilar.
Well, thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. I hope it was useful. So what is the big change that has come in with the revision this year? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Excellent. Part two. Exactly. There's not the sort of fixed role play that there was. There used to be two little, they each had a little prompt card with some prompts on it, and they had to ask each other questions. Mm-hmm. It was a little bit stilted, a little bit unnatural, and it only really looked at could they form questions. And if they couldn't, or if they were very nervous and failed to form a question, that was it, really. You always had a student saying, where is house or what time start? We've brought this in much more in line with our other speaking exams. And part two is now a collaborative task. So the candidates are given a prompt like this. It's never anything. I mean, it's very much A2. Do you like these other varieties on that general sort of theme? And it will be material like hobbies, holidays, presents, etc. Nothing extreme. Okay. Mm-hmm. And it's been extensively, all of the changes to all of our exams when they happen, they're extensively trialed and tested and pre-tested on students around the world. So before we are only when we are 100% confident that they work, do the changes, are the changes implemented? So a nice little way to prepare for this, Victoria,
We can ask our students to come up with positive and negative aspects, for example, in this case of different types of holidays. So adjectives, positive and negative. And then after that, they can write their own sentences or try to incorporate them into their conversation.
Yeah, just give them a bit of material and they can try and use them when they're speaking to each other. I don't know what approaches you're taking at the moment, teaching online. But they could record little videos to one another. They could try using an online tool to speak to one another. It's not a very complex task. So any sort of input that they can have, give them the material to use so that they can practice and feel comfortable when they get to that part in the exam. And just quickly, Coral, I'm not sure. Just A2 and B1. Okay, so just A2 key and key for schools. The young learners had a revision beforehand, so that went live in 2018. And as I said, we tend to revise our exams around between 8 to 12 years. Thank you, David. So these changes are only for A2 key and B1 preliminary. We'll be looking at B1 preliminary tomorrow. But let's carry on with this. Right. A very easy but very effective way to help them with their speaking. I think, like we were saying with writing, give them examples. So, Victoria, what are we going to do?
We're going to give them ideas about how to use our videos for about the speaking exam. So you can get your students to watch the video and then listen to the examiner asking the questions and answering the questions themselves, or just get them to listen to the candidates and think about positive aspects and things to be improved. And then you can get them to give a mark for a specific criterion, have a little discussion. So make it a bit more interactive.
Yeah, exactly. So we're going to show you the video now. We'll just give you access to another file, A2 speaking. I'm going to share that with you now. I think on there, what is on there, Victoria?
Is the speaking, the assessment criteria for the speaking paper.
I want to talk us through that.
Ooh, I don't have it in front of me, so it will be just like from memory, but they will, yes.
No, go on.
They will need to pay attention to interactive communication, also pronunciation, obviously, how they organize their ideas and the language, the grammar and vocabulary that they use. And there will also be a mark for global achievement, so how they have done in general.
Exactly. And these are our criteria are very similar. Well, they're very similar to the writing criteria in that. We have three bands with descriptors at band 1, band 3, and band 5. And so for the A2 criteria, a band 3 is A2. Okay. A band 5 in the A2 criteria is the same as a band 3 in B1. So all of the criteria overlaps between levels. So have a look at the criteria that we've downloaded, that I've given you to download. Let us know if you can't download it. And choose one of the two students. We're going to look at a video of Luca on the left and Federica on the right. And choose one or two of the criteria on what we have given you. And choose one student and try and give them a mark for this. Okay, so we'll see you in about 7 minutes. Just put the video on now.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Can I have your mark sheets, please? Thank you. I'm Sandra, and this is Kerry. What's your name?
My name is Luca.
And what's your name?
Federica.
How old are you?
I'm 13.
Where do you live?
I live in Buccinasco, a small town near Milano.
Thank you. How old are you, Luca?
I'm 13.
Where do you live?
I live in Buccinasco.
Thank you. Now, let's talk about school. Luca, what subject do you like best?
My favorite subject is English because I very like all the languages, but English is the best because I very like America.
What clothes do you wear to school?
I wear t-shirt and jeans.
Federica, what time do you finish school?
At 4:15. No.
Do you finish school at 4:00?
No, at 2:15.
What do you eat after school?
I eat pasta or meat or fish.
Now, Luca, please tell me something about the homework you have to do.
All the day I have to do my homework, and there are a lot of homework about math, Italian and English.
Do you get a lot of homework every day?
Yes.
Now let's talk about home. Federica, who do you live with?
I live with my mom, my dad and my two sisters.
How many bedrooms are there in your house?
Two. One of my parents and one for me and my sisters.
Luca, where do you watch TV at home?
I watch TV in my camera.
What's your favorite room in your house?
My bedroom.
Federica, please tell me what you like doing at home.
I like listen music, sing, and watch TV.
Do you like cooking?
No, not at all.
Now, in this part of the test, you're going to talk together. Here are some pictures that show different hobbies. Do you like these different hobbies? Say why or why not. I'll say that again. Do you like these different hobbies? Say why or why not. All right, now talk together.
I like watch TV and read the books. You like read books?
No, I prefer watch TV. And you, do you like play football?
No. Because I don't like play with balls, and you like sing or play instruments?
No, it's difficult for me. I prefer play football.
And watch TV?
Yes, I very like it because there are a lot of interesting documentary. And do you like read book?
Yes.
Luca, do you think playing football is fun?
Yes, because there are a lot of friends to talk after the match.
Do you think playing an instrument is difficult?
Yes, I think it's very difficult.
Why?
Because there are a lot of things to appear and study.
Mm-hmm. Federica, do you think playing computer games is boring?
No, I like it. Because
why not?
Because a lot of these are good and funny.
Do you think reading is interesting?
Yes, because I like read books and I like adventures book.
So Luca, which of these hobbies do you like best?
I prefer watch TV because a lot of the time I watch TV with my sister or my family.
Mm-hmm. And Federica, which of these hobbies do you like best?
Watch TV or read books.
Okay, thank you. Can I have the book now? Now, do you prefer to spend your free time alone or with other people, Federica?
With other people.
Why?
Especially with my friends, because I have a lot of fun with they, and I'm...
And what about you, Luca? Do you prefer to spend your free time alone or with other people?
I prefer stay with my friends and with other people because it's much cool and funny.
Mm-hmm. And which is more fun, playing sports or watching sports?
Watching sports.
Why?
Because it's interesting and exciting.
Mm-hmm. And you, Federica, which is more fun, playing sports or watching sports?
Playing.
Why?
Because I love doing sports and I like it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. That is the end of the test.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so that was Luca and Federica. We have some very interesting responses. On the left, oh, strict teachers, always strict. Remember, this is A2, okay? And look at the criteria, please. You will, if you came to our session on writing yesterday, you'll notice the examiners always quote the criteria, okay? And all of our criteria for writing and speaking is designed to mark positively. We're rewarding or recognizing what students can do, not what students can't do. So they are not penalized. They don't start with full marks and lose them. It is analyzing and looking at what they can do. Okay. And I know it's very tempting, Therese, to compare the two of them. But our examiners are all extensively trained on focusing on each candidate individually. Okay, so even if they were way above B1, and one was better than the other, they would still only be able to score fives across the board. I believe that's correct. That's a correct way to express it, David. David spent many years as a speaking examiner. So we have quite a mixture here. We're going to look at the examiner's comments now. Victoria?
Mm-hmm. Yes. For Luca, in terms of grammar and vocab, his grammar and vocab are sometimes correct. And although there are a few errors, what he says is generally clear. So not many impeding mistakes.
No. Federica talks very easily, gives her ideas about different things, doesn't make many mistakes with her grammar and vocab.
Mm-hmm. In terms of pronunciation, sorry, George, Luca speaks clearly and is generally easy to understand.
Yeah, Federica speaks clearly. She's easy to understand all the time. Mm-hmm. She probably gets slightly higher, slightly better mark than Luca for pronunciation. Interactive communication.
Yeah, Luca interacts very well throughout the test with both his partner and the examiner, and he has no difficulty and requires no support at all.
Federica, likewise, she interacts very well. She asks questions, answers questions, and global achievement.
Luca communicates well during the whole test, using questions and long sentences without hesitation.
Yeah. Federica as well uses complete sentences. They both deal very well with what is thrown at them. I mean, we get a little bit of L1 interference. Heard Luca saying camera, and he meant to say room, bedroom. And again, I'd like to, we're not encouraging you all to tell your students to lie. what David has said, but they're not being tested on telling the truth. So poor Federica can't remember how to say what time she finishes school.
Yeah.
So just say something. Even if she said midnight, she wouldn't be marked down. Okay. So tell them if they get into a tricky situation, just say what comes to mind.
Yeah.
Okay. So here are the marks they both got. Yeah, these were strong for A2 candidates. They both got a 4 for grammar and vocab, so they'd probably be getting a B grade on their certificates for that. Pronunciation, as I said, Federica was very slightly better than Luca. And the last two, Victoria?
Yeah, they did very well for interactive communication and global achievement, so 5 for both of them in both criteria.
Excellent. So there you are. You can access examples of further speaking tests on YouTube. Mm-hmm. There are a few available for the post revision A2. Yeah. More will come.
Mm-hmm.
You can also look at examples of the pre revision. Obviously, the task is different. If you want some examples of the kind of language that comes out at A2 and look at some further examiner's comments, that can be quite useful.
Yeah.
And Sian, 5 for pronunciation. Why not? Did you misunderstand anything that they said? Have a look at the way the criteria describes pronunciation. We are in no circumstances testing anybody's accent. Do they sound like a native speaker? No. It's about clarity, and it's about are they clear to understand, mm-hmm. really? Intonation and things come in at higher levels. But as you all know, I think English is the only language in the world that has a much higher number of non-native speakers than native speakers. So it's not to do with how good an accent they have. It's to do with how clearly
mm-hmm.
They communicate. Exactly for Fahad. Intelligibility, clarity. Okay. Right. That is it from us today.
Mm-hmm.
A few more resources to help you at the end, Victoria.
Yeah, please visit our website. This is our main website, and there is a section to support you. And there you will be able to access exam preparation resources, also links to our webinars and other useful resources for teachers, such as our Facebook and our MOOC, the Teaching English Online course that
yes.
started last week. It will go on for 4 weeks in total. You can register at any time during these 4 weeks, and you will get access to a lot of information and resources to teach online, information about platforms, so very practical.
Yes, and lastly, other useful links for you. I think all of these should be on the document that I gave you to download. We have the Supporting Every Teacher, which we looked at just now, the MOOC, also links to all of our social media. I hope you signed up for some more webinars. We look forward to seeing you or hearing from you in those.
Mm-hmm.
And any questions? Ready? We'll stay on for a couple more minutes. If anybody has any burning questions to ask us or David, whilst we're here, we're going back to that thing about pronunciation and accents. Have a look at some C2 speaking tests. Okay, listen to their pronunciation, listen to their accents. As David says, it's about intelligibility. David put it very well as an experienced speaking examiner. Control of phonological features. This is for A2 at both utterance and word levels. I think it's very interesting. Look at some speaking tests from higher levels. Compare it to the criteria as the criteria becomes more demanding at the higher levels. Alma, the writing for Key, for part 6, they have to write 25 words or more, and the part 7, 35 words or more. I've said this with other writings at other levels. Our word counts are there as guidance, okay? And there's a lot of myths that go around saying that we don't mark after the upper limit. That's a lie. Key, they do have to try and write the minimum, but there's no upper limit. And I was involved in the Young Learners Revision. I worked in Cambridge in assessment before coming to Spain. And for the Young Learners Flyers, the A2 Flyers, which is a story task, very similar to the Key task, they have to write 25 words or more. But the average number of words coming in was between 40 and 50. Okay. Yeah, well, if you have any myths, ask us during the webinars. We love busting myths. There's plenty of material online, Miguel. If you look on our website, and as I said, on Cambridge University Press's website, you will receive the certificate within the next week or two. As you can probably imagine, we're very, very busy. We're doing lots of webinars at the moment. So you will receive your certificates, but not tomorrow. Okay. Thank you, Coral. I'm glad it was useful and interesting. Oh, David's just popped up a C2 speaking test. I'll keep you all entertained for the rest of the evening. Our next webinar is tomorrow.
B1
preliminary, one at 11 o'clock Spanish time, and one at this time again at 5:30 Spanish time. There'll be a little bit of overlap from a skills level and techniques about what we've spoken about today. Things like predicting content, what's difficult about listening, how can we support with listening. But we will look in more detail at the B1 specific tasks, the writing and the speaking at the end of it. So bear with us tomorrow. I hope it's not too repetitive. Exactly, Susanna. 4:30 in Portugal, but not if you're in Madeira or Jesuris. Any questions? Anyone else? Thank you all. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you very much.
And I apologize if I talked too much today. I know sometimes I do talk too much. You just tell me, just say, George, stop, in the chat box. I've been isolated in my flat for 16 days now, so I get very excited when I end up on a webinar. Victoria as well, just say, George, shut up, stop it.
Okay, so time to go, George.
Okay, thank you. And yes, certificates will be sent. Thank you all very much. See some of you tomorrow. Okay.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you.